All right, so this next section is going to be creating informed goals, focusing on the R and SMARTY. So for those of you who attended our training last week, Reimagine Collective, we did a deep dive into campaign planning 101, and we covered a lot around SMARTY goals and creating a campaign. So today we are going to really focus in on making our goals realistic, and specifically around helping you outline your goals for Get Out the Vote efforts. And we really hope that this will be helpful for you. We want to help you think about how you want to estimate who you're going to contact, how you're going to contact them, and if you have the capacity. And if you don't, what you might need to make sure you can reach all the folks that you want to be contacting in this election. As an aside, if you are interested in recruiting poll monitors for poll monitoring work, please let us know. It will follow a similar process to what we're going to show you today, but will be a little bit different. So we're not going to cover that specifically today with regard to poll monitors. And so now I'm going to pass it over to my colleague, Brittany, who will introduce our Houston in Action Learning Team.
Thanks so much, Layla. Good morning, almost afternoon. Maybe it feels like a Friday, so hopefully we can stay energized throughout this process together. I am Brittany Fitz. I'm the Director of Collective Learning with Houston Action. And when we say collective learning, we mean everything from data, research, evaluation. If it falls under that umbrella, you'll probably engage with me at some point. But I am not alone in this process. Houston Action works with a really great team from Texas Toolbelt, and you may interact with one of them in the next few months as well. First, we have Michael. You're going to be hearing from him in a new tool he's helped us create in a little bit. But you might also receive emails from Luvia, and Maria is also joining our team, so you might be having some interactions with her later into the summer. So just so you have a face, to put with a name, especially as we start exchanging emails, I just wanted to introduce our team for you. But a little bit more housekeeping before we move into the meat of our presentation. I am a data person, we are a data team, and sometimes we can use jargon or lingo, and to kind of help us buffer that today, we have a few terms to know we're going to introduce. And we will do our best throughout the presentation to go back and kind of star those and reiterate what we mean. So the first one is going to be when we say universe. So we're going to be talking about knowing your universe, who's in your universe. And all we mean is that it is a list of people that you have the potential to talk to, right? So maybe this is limited by a zip code or demographic. When we say universe, it is the people you have the potential to talk to. When we talk about tactics, sometimes we use the word tactic, activity, strategy. They're kind of interchangeable. And we're going to be using the term tactic, and this is the tools or the methods that you're going to use to reach your goals. Then we also have contact rate. So this is going to be a formula. This is going to be the number of people that you made contact with, you had a conversation with, over the total number of people that you attempted to reach. So think about it as the number of conversations versus the number of dials to a particular phone number or set of numbers. And then the last one we're going to talk about is hot leads. Hot leads is a classification for the people that you're going to be talking to. And basically a hot lead just means that you have some type of connection with an individual that is in your universe. Maybe they've attended an event that you've hosted, maybe they're on your mailing list, but there's someone you've already talked to. And a hot lead is in direct comparison to a cold call. So think of those telemarketers that call you all the time and you pick up the phone and you have no idea who you're talking to. That is an example of a cold call. So a hot lead versus a cold call. So those are just some terms, but for review for everyone here, SMARTY goals. If you've worked with us, you know we love our SMARTY goals, and SMARTY goals are just a way for us and you all to track your work in a way that is strategic, measurable, attainable. We lean towards the ambitious, your goals that are realistic, they're time bound, so maybe they fall within like a quarter, month, or even just a campaign year. And what's really important for us here at Houston Action is that we're also looking to make sure that these goals are inclusive and equitable. But for today, we're really going to dive into this idea of realistic. We fully put the goal setting into your hands, and you are allowed to pick goals that make sense for your organization. But one thing we've noticed over the previous campaigns is that we don't necessarily give you the tools to help make those realistic decisions. Can you call 3,000 people? Can you talk to 500 people? What does that really look like for you and your organization? So we're gonna try to give you a few tools to help address that realistic component in today's presentation. To cover a few best practices we have around campaign work, I'm gonna kick it over to Chris, and he's gonna walk us through a few components.
Thank you, Brittany. Hello, excited to be here. Hello, everybody. Chris Valdez, I use he, him pronouns. I am on the communications team at Houston in Action. I am excited to be in this place of our campaign ramp up with all of you. Some of you new, some of you who we've worked together before. Love it. Just going to mention a few, I guess, really food for thought here on approaches to some of the direct voter outreach and other activities that you all may be embarking on, considering for your plans right now. These are things that have I think been more recent learnings post 2020 and some dating much further back than that, but things that were tried out and seen as solutions for different scenarios. I'm going to also just lightly touch on them here, but share some links in the chat as well. For people to do deeper dives into some of these concepts. You're free to do your own research. There's lots of information out there, so take it at your own pace. But the first one I'm gonna mention is relational approaches. And a relational approach to your voter outreach really is about who you're reaching out to. It's thinking about the people that you already know or the people that might already know you and building on that existing relationship. Something I should mention up at the top too is just calling back in from the training that we had with the Reimagine Collective, thinking about that ladder of engagement that we learned about, moving people through a process over time. And a relational approach can do that. You can take someone who just might know your name and move that to someone who's willing to have a conversation with you, or someone who's then willing to take action that you might have. In this case, we're talking about getting people registered to vote or out to vote as you build upon that relationship with somebody who you already have an entry point with. That's not a cold call. It can be very effective and a good use of time. Another approach is called multi-mode, or sometimes it's called layered approaches. So this is really thinking about the tactics you employ to do your outreach. Thinking about, maybe you might call someone initially, but maybe the next time around, you're thinking about knocking on their door, or you're thinking about targeting an ad, a digital ad that might reach them. Thinking multimodal, so different tactics, same person, and even in ideal circumstances, the same person doing the outreach. So maybe the same person that knocks on the door is the same person who called or texts. And again, thinking back about the ladder of engagement, how you move people to sort of higher commitment, bigger asks along that ladder. And then the third is something we're actually piloting right now and hoping to introduce to each of the voter engagement groups is the Houston Action Digital Organizing and Learning Program, which is really a mashup of relational approaches and multi-mode approaches, but using digital organizing and trying to think about that not as just like showing up to talk to folks with digital ads in September to be like, hey, you wanna go register to vote? But starting earlier, so maybe starting next month or as soon as possible to begin to start the type of conversation that we would love to have in person, but doing it online. So learning a little bit more about them as we move through, the time between now, May and November, to grow an online relationship with that person, but eventually, for those who are interested in engaging in more real, in real life activities, bringing those activities into real life and developing a relationship that we, an understanding of that person where we actually know how to motivate them when it comes to get registered to vote or when it comes to actually getting out and voting. And this approach is actually meant to extend beyond the election season. But so folks who are opting into the digital organizing and learning program, we hope to take those relationships that are built and activate people around the issues that you, you think about and work on a daily basis outside of elections. Next year's a legislative session. Certainly there will be opportunities to activate people then as well. But beyond that, really a long-term view there. And then of course, going to open it up because I know that you all have your own experience, what it's taken to get people engaged, to move people into leadership, to get volunteers, to get people out to vote or get registered to vote. So maybe if we can hear from, I'm not exactly sure how we are on time, but maybe do we have time for two or three responses? Okay, cool. So I'm gonna open it up here to see. Yeah, thank you for adding those links. And so if you just wanna come off mute or if you want to drop your name in the chat, we can call on you to share something that's worked to engage people to action in your previous experience or in your campaigns. See your note here, Nancy. Yeah, go ahead.
Just really quickly, something that I've learned that has worked when I've done like outreach work and independent expenditures is that people just really like to talk to people that they know and trust. And so when I was worked for the union and we would do our independent expenditure work, I always really encourage my member leader volunteers to help me cut turf and think like strategically through like, okay, you live in this neighborhood or you go to this church or you work at this particular school, because me coming up to the door, I'm just kind of like a used car salesman, but that person that they know very well or that they have a relationship with, those words just travel a little bit further and are a little bit more significant.
Yeah, exactly. Perfect example of a relational approach. Someone who's got that face or name recognition, getting out there first. Can we hear from maybe one more person?
Can I chime in?
Please.
This is Nancy with League of Women Voters. And I just want to emphasize that our approach this year is going to be collaborative and to partner with as many groups as we can, maybe providing them with push cards to give at their events, providing them with suggestions, and try to get everybody rowing in the same direction. But one of the things that we're doing that I think is really worth discussing and thinking about, and I put it in the chat already, is that we are going to call our Get Out the Vote efforts voter empowerment drives. Because we look at the United States right now and we've decided that we want voters to feel empowered. And we've used the term GOTV for a million years, and Texas has abysmally low voter turnout. So I would just encourage people to kind of think outside the box on even what we're calling it. So anyway, voter empowerment drives. And I got that from the Harris County Election Office. One of the coordinators used that term and I said, I love it. And then I was on a panel at the state convention, the League of Women Voters State Convention, and they all loved it. And different groups that I partnered with, they're like, oh, we're gonna use that. So anyway, that's my contribution.
That's great, thank you so much. Collaboration and language.
This is Jesse Mona, can you hear me?
I sure can, Jesse. And then follow after Jesse Mona, we'll have Elmer, and I'll read what Marla shared in the chat.
I just wanted to say real quick that I'm with Pure Justice, and what we've been doing is going into the county jail, registering inmates who are off paper, and they are just so impressed that someone even thought about them to come in and do that, because it's like the forgotten, population. A lot of people don't even know that if they have a felony, but they've satisfied their mandate of getting off parole or probation, they paid their restitution, in Texas, they can vote. So we give them a little information, let them know where we are and what we're doing, and we've been signing up some guys. And so it's been really good, really rewarding to be able to do that.
Powerful. Yeah, just thinking about new places that voters are, that aren't being considered. Thank you for that. Elmer.
Yes, good morning. Elmer from Crescent. We are using, you know, an approach that we call the domino effect. For example, we are targeting in the Latinx community people who they can vote, but they have daughters and sons, and particularly the TPS holders. We had a meeting last night with 30 leaders here in the Southwest. And it was a very successful, you know, approach because we right now we have a data with some daughters and some from those people that they are able to vote. So we are kind of using that strategy. So I just sharing this idea, how to approach the Latinx community and get more results. Thank you.
Love that. Finding the connection points. That's beautiful work. Thank you, Elmer. Thank you, everybody. I know we're short on time, so I'm going to pass things back. Thank you to everybody who contributed. And Marla, I appreciate your comments too on following up with people, remembering their names, even if they can't talk right in that moment. That's awesome. Awesome. And with that, we'll pass it back to Layla. Thank you.
Thanks, Chris. And thank you everyone for adding all of these thoughts here. Please keep adding them in the chat. This is really great. And I know it's giving everyone lots of ideas. We'd love to hear what y'all are doing. So we're going to go into some easy steps that we put together for really making your goals that you're outlining for yourself realistic and attainable. Really quick, I want to make sure that folks have this. We just share it in Basecamp, but want to share it again. We have this great document, this digital workbook, if you will, that was created with Reimagine Collective, and we've adapted it for today. So it has everything from last week's session, but it also includes today's training slides, a link to sign up for office hours, the training from last week. And in the workbook, we added this section for today specifically. So when you open it and you click four steps to realistic, it'll take you right to this section. And as we go through the slides, you can work in here. You just make a copy and you can edit it yourself. And you can go ahead and start to outline some of these things if you haven't already. So I'm just gonna redrop this in the chat for everybody. So you have it. And so yes, you go to file, make a copy, and then you'll be able to access it and edit it as we go along. So we're gonna keep this section brief because we're gonna actually go through each one after we introduce them to you and do some examples. So high level, four steps to realistic is one, review your previous work. What worked, what didn't work? Thinking about, did you meet your intended outcomes? Number two, know your universe. And so as Britt outlined earlier, that means the folks that you want to contact. So whether that's by zip code, by precinct, by demographic, by neighborhood that you work in. Three, understanding your capacity to actually engage in the work and reach those folks. And then four, leaning into the ambitious. So under review previous work, some things that you might want to ask yourself to help you figure out where you've been and where you want to go. Identifying how many people you contacted during the last election or during the last year in 2020, and thinking about how did I reach those folks? What helped me achieve my goal? Or maybe if I wasn't able to achieve my goal, what were some of the barriers to success for my organization or my team that was working on this? Thinking through who are the folks that I worked with? Who are the partners that I engaged in the community, in the region to achieve my goals? Who supported me in my efforts? Who did I work with and how did we collaborate and support each other's efforts? Listing those folks out. Identifying what tactics and activities or strategies that you use that you want to continue, and thinking back and talking to your team about what worked, why did we like this, why was it successful, and making sure you really understand that are those worth engaging in again, and are there maybe other things that we want to try. knowing your universe. So who do you want to contact this year? Something we want to emphasize is the more focused that you are, the more focused your impact will be. So some things to think about are, you know, do I want to look at my voter universe by zip code? If so, that's a huge area, right? That's a lot more folks. Do I want to focus on specific precincts in my area? Do I want to contact everybody with a phone number and a specific zip code? Do I want to try to connect with every registered voter who's in a certain age range in the county? And then thinking through, how do I get this information? Once you've figured out and you've narrowed in on who do I want to contact? Does this make sense? Is this who I should be engaging with, or who I already am engaging with? Figuring out, how do you get that data? So I want to pause really quick and invite Michael to talk about a tool that we have available to support this.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Layla, I am going to share my screen, if you don't mind.
I can actually share. I have it right here if that's helpful.
Oh, that would be great. Yeah, perfect, yeah. Perfect. So good morning, y'all. Thank you for the folks that are letting me into your home this morning or office. It's good to see you. I'm glad I'm here. We're going to walk through this as if I was an organization doing this planning kind of from a one-on-one standpoint. So Layla, I'm going to just kind of start at the top and walk folks through what I put together. First with instructions for how to do this on your own later. And if you're worried about this is at any point, I do want to just lift up that there will be office hours here. But to start, when you get access to this document, you're going to go to File and make a copy if you're used to working in Google Docs. If you're somebody who prefers to work in Excel, you can go to File, Download, and work in Excel. Right up at the top, we have a link to a map that's going to help us provide additional context to the list of precincts that we're going to be looking at in just a second. But I want to start by giving everybody a whole overview of the county, right? So this is just, as of right now, who do we have on the voter file rolls? Who has a history of voting? What does that look like as far as comparison to total population counts versus how many doors are there that we would like to knock on? And in addition to that, how many cell phones are available? How many landlines, right? And so this is kind of just a way to get an idea from the top, looking at all of Harris County, just kind of what information we have on folks to try and begin reaching out to them during our voter engagement campaign. In addition to that, the next section below is just election history. So for folks that aren't familiar with flows of elections, consistently we see in what are referred to, unfortunately, as off years, even though I don't think there are off years. In midterm elections, you'll see a decrease a little bit in voter participation and turnout. And so this is a way to also just provide additional context for you and planning and looking back to see, okay, how many folks voted really like pre-COVID, how many folks voted absentee compared to the 2020 election, right? Like that number is not too different. So that's really fascinating. There's just some stuff and information there that's gonna help you provide context for what we're looking at. And you can see we've got folks' vote method, mostly for the most case, we've got an understanding of how folks voted for a lot of people there. So it's just gonna give you some idea of how Harris County behaves in elections. And then we just gave you kind of the last two most recent elections to take a shot at. For planning purposes, if anybody's a turnout nerd and wants to look at the numbers, I would highly recommend you stick with the 2018 election results. It's the last most similar election. And so it's gonna be the best guideline for you looking at 2022. Below that, we've got some demographic information and we can cut really deep here if anybody's interested or wants to learn more. But again, this is just to serve as an overview of Harris County to give you all some guideposts along the way as you look into your planning. So we've got information on folks based on their voter score. And what the voter score did here was just count of the last five elections, how many did those people participate in? So starting at the top left, a frequent voter is somebody that is voted in three or four out of the last five elections. And we'll include notes on this. Infrequent is two or three out of the last five. Never voted, obviously 0-5. And then our super voters are 5 out of 5, right? So this is just a way to give us a snapshot and insight here. And I do have a note on the demographic information about where this information did come from, if you're curious. Moving over, we have got information on race, age, and as well as income. So this is a way to kind of provide insight into the county overall. But where we want to start in universe building is centering ourselves around people, right? And so, Layla, I would ask for you first, if you don't mind, could you click the link to the January Advisors map on and open that in a new tab? And then if I could also ask you to go back to the voter engagement workbook and select on the third tab, voters by precinct. So in this scenario, I'm gonna act like I was getting ready to plan this out here. You can see on the left-hand side, there's the precinct numbers. There are 1,012 precincts in Harris County for anybody that's curious or interested. You can see them all listed here, as well as how many voters are in each of those precincts, right? And so this is a way for us to understand how many folks are there. And this is how you wanna start building your base, right? Just working on how many people are here, how many people are gonna be in the area that I wanna do to be exploring voter engagement with, right? Okay, so that's our first list. And in this example, I'm gonna continue to use precincts. And to get deeper insight into that in my neighborhood and some other information, I'm gonna use the map that's been provided in the link. So Layla, if you wouldn't mind selecting that second part, awesome. If you look on the left-hand side, there's a geography column underneath the, on the left-hand side of the menu bar. And Layla, would you mind selecting under select geography voting precincts? Awesome. So what that's gonna do is give you an insight into what Harris County looks like with the precinct lines. These precinct lines are updated. There's all 1,012 precincts on this map for you to look at. And what it's gonna do is give you a count and insight into the numbers of precincts, the actual precinct number that is around you or in areas you're familiar with organizing in, so that you can kind of claim those for your voter engagement work. What we wanna do is work together as a county to make sure that anybody who's engaged in voter engagement work has some sense of where folks are working so that we can make sure we're helping each other out along the way. So that if one person notices that a building is inaccessible, maybe it's a high rise, maybe it's a gated community, that the next time folks don't have to go back there, right? And so that's just in the interest of everyone. And so that's what we wanna do here. You can see, Layla, I don't know if you wanna just kind of pick a neighborhood and zoom in. I think that's just a good way to start. And you can see there's precinct 241. And here I have population information, information on age, ethnicity, diaspora communities, folks that are foreign born, the population by race, non-citizen population, renters, median household income, and a lot of other information. So this is a way that you're gonna start by looking at the list, looking at how many people might be there, or looking at your neighborhood. And then what that's gonna allow you to do is build up a size. Again, centering yourself on people to give you a concept of what your universe is going to look like so that we can go into the next phase of, okay, now how are we going to talk to them? How are we going to make sure the apartment folks get mail and we don't try to send folks into high rises they can't get access to? How do we make sure that we're calling young people on their cell phones directly or sending them text messages, right? So we can really kind of dig in after this next step. But this is really to give you an overview and help you in your planning purposes. You will have to have both screens open. So I encourage like working together as a team or in conjunction with other folks, make sure that you have the list of how many people are in the precinct in your voter engagement workbook. And then you're gonna use the link in the map to kind of focus centering on your neighborhoods by voting precincts and then build your universe. After that, once you've got the precincts and areas you know you're gonna be working in, you have a total count of how many people are gonna be in your universe. And we're ready to get started. And that's when we can really get into the details later. But yeah, that's how this is gonna work for folks. Happy to field questions, but again, also wanna lift up office hours. Layla, I don't know if you need anything else from me. Can I pass the baton back to you? Awesome, thanks y'all.
Amazing, oh my gosh, Michael, you are amazing. So those links are in the chat and we will also share them out with you as a part of the digital workbook that we're working on today. And as Michael mentioned, we will be offering office hours. And before we end today, we will reshare how to sign up for that and the dates and times for this. So the third step, once you've identified all of this amazing data and you know what it is that you know who it is that you are focused on and where you're focused on, the third step is to identify if you have the capacity as an organization to reach these folks. So thinking through, how has my organization capacity changed from the last election? Maybe you have more staff now, which would be amazing, right? Maybe you have more volunteers and you've grown your base so you can actually reach more folks. You know, do you need more staff? Do you need more volunteers? Do you have enough time to reach the folks that you need to reach, depending on your capacity? These are questions that we should be asking ourselves so we can be really strategic and thoughtful of how we're using our own time and resources. And as a note, we do want to lift up that, you know, you can say, I want to have this many conversations with people, and know that you're going to have to reach out, you're going to have to attempt to reach out to a lot more folks in order to have those conversations. So, you know, just like with anything, if we invite 200 people to an event, we know there's a percentage that aren't going to show up. So how do we make sure that we have the time to really do that follow-up and connect with the people that we want to contact? And then 4, lean into the ambitious. So what are the things that are working in your favor? What's going to help you boost that contact rate that we're talking about? What's going to help you reach the people that you want to reach? So as we talked about, hot leads versus cold calls, making sure that you're connecting with people you already know or who know you. So the people who are in your newsletter list, your clients, your members, people who've attended all of your past events or workshops or trainings that you've done, anyone who already has a connection with your organization or maybe a coalition that you're a part of in your neighborhood, those are the folks that you can reach out to, and they'll already recognize who you are. We know that face-to-face interactions are more time intensive, but they are also a lot more personal than sending a text message. So when you're going door to door, you're going to have more volunteers and more time to do that versus, you know, just texting a whole lot of people, but you'll also have really meaningful conversations. And then as Chris was talking about, layered approach versus single approach, think about how you can connect with people in multiple ways across different platforms and different tactics. So you have your workbook, you're outlining these things, and now we're going to go into an example. So I'm going to pass it over to Brent.
Thanks, Leila and Michael. Those were fantastic steps, and now we're going to put them into practice. So we're going to be playing with a fake organization called Alpha Daisy, and their goal is to mobilize voters in 76701. If you know me, I'm from Waco. This is my zip code, so I pick something close to home. Alpha Daisy is an organization that works primarily with young adults, providing support they need to graduate. They work mostly in community and technical colleges. And you know, they haven't done previous election work, but they know when they're trying to reach out to their students, they find it easier to text or make a phone call. And it's sometimes hard to engage those students if they don't have a device in their hand. So when they're going through this workbook and thinking through, and maybe some tactics that have worked prior and that they want to pull into their election planning, they definitely want to focus on text banking, phone banking, and maybe some door-to-door canvassing, because they do have a captive audience of students that live in student housing. And so thinking about what their population is, the area, the zip code that they're in, they can start targeting some specific tactics and that they want to incorporate things that have worked before that they can move forward. So that's reviewing the previous work. If we move on to knowing their universe. So, you know, for Alpha Daisy, they're looking at students, mostly between the ages of 18, 24. But because they work in technical and community colleges, they know that they also have a really strong non-traditional student population. So they want to incorporate not just student housing, but they want to incorporate the entire zip code and where potential members could live. But they have an active client base. They are working with students across these campuses. So they are going to take a dual approach. So taking maybe a list of phone numbers from the universe of 76710, but they also have a list of their current members. And so they have 1,400 students or residents in 76710, and they have an active client list. And we can take those two lists, we can compare them, and we can see that in their student list, there's about 200 students that don't live in that zip code, and they wanna make sure they're drawing that contact. So if we take 1,400 plus 200, we have a total universe for Alpha Daisy around 1,600 people that they could contact during their election campaign. And a point, one of the things that we talked about was having the number of voters in your area. If you want to get more detailed, like if you want to look at a demographic, or if you want to look at an age ranges within those particular precincts, we can help you and assist you getting those numbers to help narrow down your universe as well. So just a point of clarification there. When we move into understanding our capacity, I'm thinking about what has the staffing changed in Alpha Daisy? You know, maybe they've hired a new student services coordinator. Hey, Nancy, happy midway. They've hired a new coordinator, so maybe they have a little bit larger of a capacity, and maybe that coordinator can bring in some students to help with some volunteer hours that are coming in. And they've also had a massive upgrade on their computers and software, so they are ready to go with their work. And so those are some things that we can start thinking about. They are targeting a younger audience, and they really want to take a look at what a digital campaign could add to this work. Now, Layla mentioned an interesting statistic earlier, that for you are only going to reach about 20% of those that you try to make contact with, or you can only have a conversation with about 20% of those that you call or text. So if we take that entire universe of 1,600, multiply it by 20%, we know we can have about 320 conversations. So when you're thinking about considering your work, we really want to focus on that 1,600, that total universe. You're going to spend a lot of time knocking on doors that aren't going to be answered, calling numbers that aren't going to be answered. But when you do make those connections, making the most of them. So we have new tactics to incorporate. And now we've really narrowed down a realistic goal for our conversations. It's about 320. Now, we always tell you to lean into the ambitious. So if we think about some things that are going to help boost that contact score just a little bit, or that contact rate, we have about, some of our list is actually their warm leads, their hot leads, and they're people that we already work with, that are on our client roll, they're members of our organization. That's going to help boost that contact rate. Alpha Daisy is also thinking about doing a layered approach. So can they do a social media or a digital campaign? Maybe that digital campaign is followed up by a text message saying, you know, hey, did you see our ad, or think about this, or whatsoever your script might be. But that follow-up text message, when they see your name in the text message, they may have already seen it on a digital campaign tool. Same if you text and then maybe you go door knocking. Someone's more likely to open the door for you if they already know your name and your organization. And so thinking of that layered approach, how can you build on those contacts, not just to increase your likelihood of talking to that person, but bringing that person into the fold of your organization. And then also being able to follow that individual tracking across tactics. So we will always push for you all to track individual level data. So you know who out of your list did you text, who out of your list did you door knock. So you're not necessarily duplicating your efforts or calling the same people six or seven times, because that's when you start getting angry responses from people. And so if we take all this into consideration, we can say this is probably going to boost our contact rate. And so we can estimate that we'll probably have about 360, 370 conversations. This is a really quick example of how to use these steps. And we are always we're always happy to walk through this with you. So I think one put the link to office hours, and we have one or two more this week and then one next week. So if this is of interest to you or you want to dive deeper, we can definitely do so. And this example only mentioned one of the tactics that we have or that our organizations use. So Layla, if you go to the next slide. We just wanted to give you a few other considerations of things to think about. And we know, again, this is not all of the tactics or activities we use, but this is just something to think about. We know that the more intensive a tactic is, so like door-to-door canvassing, the higher that contact rate is going to be. So door-to-door canvassing, you can expect a contact rate of about 20%. When you're door-to-door canvassing, you also need to think about, are you going to be doing just a flyer drop, or maybe you're just hanging a door knocker, or are you hoping to have conversations? That difference within that tactic is going to, you need to think about hours and time spent. If you're just dropping stuff off, it's maybe a minute per address. If you're going into a conversation, you can think about having maybe 10, 15, 20 minutes at a location. So you're going to need to think about budgeting time. Michael pointed out earlier, thinking about apartment complexes, if you know that your community is majority single family homes, it takes much longer to walk from one door to the next door in a residential neighborhood than it would in an apartment complex. Something else to think about in an apartment complex is, do you have access to that complex? Is it gated? Do you need to contact the complex manager before you go into that space? And when we think about phone banking, we think it has about a 7 to 12% response rate. If you're using the tools provided by Houston Action, it does require a minimum of 5 callers per shift in order for the auto dialer to engage. And we do recommend the auto dialer, because even though it does take off like 30 seconds of typing in a number, it does reduce that human error. So that your callers are calling the people you're intending them to call. And when we have callers, we estimate that a really experienced phone caller, a phone banker, can call about 150 calls per shift. Per shift, and that's about 3 hours. So that can help you budget how many shifts or people you need to bring into your phone banking. And then again, hot leads versus cold calling. If somebody recognizes your organization's name, they're more likely to pick up in that scenario. And we also have text banking. Text banking is going to fall into about 3 to 7% contact rate. It is the least time consuming, but it's probably the lowest return. And text messages are very easy to ignore. I'm sure we all have some on our phones that are sitting unread. The only exception for this is if you are looking at a young adult population. So that 18 to 29, research shows there's actually a really strong return rate and our contact rate for the youth population, especially if they're already in your world, if you've already spoken with them before. And then tabling or going to an event, really we want to make sure that if you are spreading voter education at either an election related event or an election non-related event, you're always thinking about what's next. What's that follow up? So are you going to have individuals sign up for a newsletter, maybe use an iPad, or are you going to have them physically sign up on a sign up sheet? Are you doing pledge cards at these events? For this, we really need to think about printing costs, but also the time it takes for you to enter all of that information. It does nobody good if we have a stack of pledge cards at the end of the day that sit in a closet. So again, thinking about all of that information. Two things that kind of run across all of these tactics is that if you are paid staff versus volunteers, think about a paid staff, maybe they're on your staff or maybe you're contracting with them. But what's really critical about this is that they do not have to go through training every single time they come in. They can come into your organization and just start going. If you are working with primarily volunteers who are going to be changing on a daily or weekly basis, you need to make sure you factor in time to train them. The better trained your volunteers are, the more likely you're going to get those conversations. And single versus multiple passes. So for each of these tactics, we need to be reaching out to individuals at least 3 times per tactic. So when Chris was talking about our relational organizing, you're going to have a greater contact if there's the same person is reaching out over and over again, and building on that relational aspect, face to a name, a conversation, a trusted person that they can ask questions for. And so these are just some considerations to take into account. We do have like 7 minutes left, so I want to make sure we have lots of time for Q&A. And I do see some in the chat already. But if you have considerations that you take in your planning that we did not talk about today, please feel free to share those in the chat. So I'm going to kick it back over to, I think, Juan or Layla to feed some questions.
Yeah, so we do have a couple minutes for questions. And I see Juan has responded to one in the chat, but I'm just going to read one of them out loud. I think it was from Crystal. So in our applications, we may have orgs that focus on the same zip code. Would it be better for us to narrow down the zip codes we want to work in? How will we coordinate TURF and voter lists so there's not multiple orgs focusing on one zip code or area of town? And then Juan, do you want to, or whoever wants to take that question and answer it, feel free to hop off mute.
Yeah, so the deadline for the Black voter, for those of you who are members of the Black Voter Engagement Working Group, the deadline for your addendums with your three SMARTI goals for voter engagement and also your interest forms if you want to revise them. The interest form asks for the zip codes where you want to work. So you can also go back and change that. The deadline will be April 24th. So that's not this Sunday, but the next one. And then after that, the funding process team in the Black Voter Engagement Working Group will meet with the HIA team and we'll get an idea of all the zip codes where organizations want to work. And then we'll have that information to then meet as a working group to coordinate TURF. That being the same thing will happen with the Latinx organizing and voter engagement cohort, just that the deadline is a little bit sooner. It's April 19th, but same process. We're gonna make sure to share contact lists for everybody who's in the Latinx cohort and the Black Voter Engagement Working Group. So that if you wanna go ahead and start having conversations about where folks are gonna work, you can go ahead and do that. You know, there's no reason to wait till later on in the month to start doing that planning. But it is something that the HIA team is aware of and that we would do in May with each working group. So
yeah, and I just want to add like a thought that came to mind when I was reading your question, Crystal, and for other folks who have a similar question. As Michael said, it's really about the relationships with people that you have. And so while there may be multiple organizations working in an area, thinking about how you interact within that zip code and what relationships you hold and maybe which parts of the community or which folks that you're reaching out to you have the best relationships with. So that way you aren't duplicating efforts and you're really maximizing the relationships that you have with those folks. So that frees up additional capacity and resources for you, or you know, work together and say, okay, well, this is how we're going to navigate this and make multiple passes based on our relationships and where people engage with us as a really sophisticated way of doing your outreach. So I know we only have 3 more minutes and we will have office hours. I know Juan put that in the chat and we'll share a slide with all of that information as well. If you go back to the workbook, you will see at the top the link to sign up for office hours. So you can sign up there on Mobilize. And this is what the page will look like. You'll go in and you'll select the time that works best for you. Of course, you know, if we realize there's like 20 people who want office hours, we will reach out to you and figure out a time to meet with you. And we can navigate those schedules with you. So we are here for you as a resource for that. We do want to sort of get a sense of how you're all feeling. So what do you think? How are you feeling? And if you can use your hands on your screen, if you can come on your camera. So 5, feeling solid, no questions, ready to go. 4, almost there, just a little left out to sort. 3, I'm still processing. I may sign up for office hours. 2, just getting started. I will likely sign up for office hours. And then 1, I'm starting from scratch and I'll definitely be coming to office hours. We can sort of get a temperature check on how you're all feeling.
Can you go to the slide, Layla?
Oh, you're not seeing it. Sorry about that. There you go. Still had the wrong tab open. And putting in the chat too is great. Yeah, 3, 4, 3, 2, 3.5. I love this. The scale you're adding. Awesome. And of course, feel free to email us, reach out to us. Yes, be honest. We're here to help you. Awesome. So as we mentioned, we have additional support for you available. We have our office hours that will be led primarily by Juan, Brittany, Chris, and I will be there to help you work through this. And we also have an evaluation we'd love for you to fill out. Britt is going to link that in the chat for us. It should take less than 5 minutes to fill out, but we'd love to get your feedback on both portions of today's meeting. So if you were here for the Boulder Advocacy training, please fill that out so we can make sure we continue to provide resources that are helpful for you in engaging in nonprofit advocacy work. And then the second part is about the second part of our training, which is the SMARTY goals and creating informed goals for your Get Out the Vote campaigns. So that feedback is super helpful for us and will also help us make these trainings better in the future and know what additional support we can provide you. And Juan, I'll let you take this last slide.
What's that? Did you need me to do something?
Yeah, if you want to take this last slide of next steps.
Cool. So these are our upcoming meetings. The Latinx Organizing and Voter Engagement Cohort and the Black Voter Engagement Working Group. You all created funding process teams. So we'll be meeting after those deadlines for your interest forms and your addendums. Tammy on the HIA team just sent out an email to members of the AAPI table where it was just yesterday where we had to make the change. So we'll be meeting either on Monday or Tuesday. So make sure to respond to that email. And then these are our upcoming trainings here as well. We'll make sure that the links to sign up go out in a follow-up email and a follow-up Basecamp message.
Thank you all so much. This has been really awesome. I've learned a lot. And we will see you for our next coming trainings and for our office hours. Feel free to reach out to us if you have any questions, concerns, or want additional support. We're here for you. And that's it. That's our training.
Thank you.